controls, owns the person who is under his grasp. Now, for every time we think of demon possession, there's always a familiar question that comes up in me. And that question is, can Satan or can demons possess a Christian person? Can a Christian person be possessed by demons? It comes up often. Let's put the question in perspective. We are saying that demon possession is ownership. The demon or Satan taking ownership of the person that the demon possesses. So the question really is, can Satan own or control believers? Can Satan or demons own or control believers? Now, in answering this question, there are two things I believe that we need to get a grip on very early. And those two things are, who are considered believers? And the other thing is, who owns believers? Who owns believers? So let's in our attempt to answer that question. The question is, can Christians be possessed by a demon? We want to begin answering that question by looking at who is a believer. One of the things that we encounter in the Christian church today is that we use a lot of words very loosely. Christian, as far as I'm concerned, is a very loose word. Because for a lot of people, everybody who picks up a Bible and walks with it is a Christian. Do you know? That is not. That is not. That is not. Who is a believer? And believer is one of those words. If you check the dictionary, it would say a believer is a person who believes in the truth or existence of something. A believer is a person who believes in the truth or existence of something. But when we look at the Bible, James chapter 2, verse 19, James says, he was speaking, he says, look, you believe that there is one God. That's good. But even the demons believe that, I'm sure. And the truth is, we won't call demons believers, though they believe that there is one God. So, this verse in James 2:19 seems to say to us that there is more to being a believer than just believing. There is more to being a believer than believing. One of the things we say all the time about, no, belief and faith is the same word. And one of the things we always say is this: belief dictates behavior. Belief dictates behavior. We have chairs in church, and you walk into the church, and you believe the chair to take you away, you will sit there. If you do not believe the chair will take you away, you will not sit there. Belief dictates behavior. So, when it comes to Christianity, belief or a believer for us is not just somebody who believes in the truth or the existence of God or of Jesus Christ. It is the behavior that goes with that belief. There are two terms that I use in relation to believers that I would like for us to think about this. First, true believer. A true believer. Or let me go to false believer first. little false belief. When you look at the NIV, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26 of the NIV, Paul writing to the Corinthians, he says this: I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. And in danger of false believers. As far as Paul was concerned, there are false believers. Peter, writing to the church in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, he says this: there will be false prophets among you. He was not speaking about people on television. He said among you. He was speaking about people in the local church, because it was the church he was speaking to. He was speaking to people about people in the church, members of the local congregation. There are false prophets among them. I was reading a writer who said this. He says, Satan specializes in counterfeit. That's what he is. He's a counterfeit boss. So, he has a counterfeit or a false gospel. That Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 to 9 tells us that. That he has a false gospel. Preached by false ministers. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 1 to 15, talks about false teachers. They produce false Christians. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26, Paul speaks about that, false believers. Of course, if you are teaching false, then the people who will believe what you are teaching, and of course, they will be learning the false. And Satan plants his counterfeit wherever God plants true believers. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13, verses 24 to 30. Matthew there, Jesus there, gave the parable of the plant of the wheat and the tares. And the owner of the field saying to his workers, no, do not attempt to pick the tares, to remove the tares from among the wheat, because in so doing, you might very well remove wheat. Verses 36 to 43 of Matthew 13, Jesus explaining that parable to his disciples, says that. He says that at harvest time, there will be a separation. God will make a separation. Everybody grows together. There are not separate. Who's saying this? So, we are told directly that there are false beliefs. It's not a nice truth, but it's a truth. If there are false believers, then it stands by reason that there will be true believers. True believers. A true believer is a dedicated follower or disciple, especially a person whose devotion to another or to a cause that is unquestioned. A person who believes in a cause so much they don't question. A person who is devoted is a true believer. As it relates to Christianity, a true believer is one who, having by faith received Christ as Lord and Savior, and that person embarks on a life of following Jesus, motivated by the gospel, empowered by the enabling of the Holy Spirit and under the authority of the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. The true believer accepts, among other things, certain foundational truths of Christianity, such as the deity and humanity of Jesus Christ, the virgin conception and birth of Jesus Christ, the priesthood of all believers, that Christ's righteousness is freely and graciously, objectively, and legally credited to us in virtue of Christ's sinless substitutionary death and glorious resurrection. A true believer believes in the fundamental principle that Jesus Christ is the sole head and high priest of the church. Romans chapter 8, verse 9, Paul said to the Roman Christians, "But you are not ruled by your sinful self, but by the Spirit, if that Spirit of God really lives in you. But the person who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Christ." You cannot be controlled by the Spirit of God if you do not have the Spirit of God. And if you do not have the Spirit of God, then you do not belong to Christ. The thought, they are true believers and they are false. Peter writes about true believers and false believers. In 2 Peter chapter 1, he speaks about verses 1 to 11, he speaks about true believers. In 2 Peter chapter 2, he speaks about false believers. And if you just put these two verses together, you will see the comparison. You'll see the difference between true and false believers. Peter said, And not only did he make reference to true and false believers, but he also made reference to true and false prophets and teachers. Peter says, in chapter 1, verses 16 and 19, Peter says, "The true teacher sources what he says from the Bible." The true teacher sources what he says from the Bible. The false teacher makes up his own messages. He tells people what they want to hear. He says that in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 3. Tells people what they want to hear. He appealed to their flesh in verse 18. That's a note to us. Be careful who you listen to. Be careful what you're taught. Ensure that it is the word of God that is being taught. People have a lot of fancy words, and there are some people who are bold and tongue, they could talk, they could chat. Do not, like the Bible says, don't be tossed to and fro by all kinds of women about it. Know what the word says and stand on the word. I stand on the word, I stand on the promise. Know the word of God, know the promise of God. Peter says, the true teacher makes Jesus Christ central to his teaching. The central truth of the gospel is Jesus Christ. And that's what the true teacher does. He says that in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Of the false teacher, he says in verse 1 of chapter 2, the false teacher moves subtly away from the centrality of Jesus Christ. He will speak about how people other than Jesus Christ can help change your life. There are people who believe in a lot of quote-unquote spirituality. Fix your business. Whatever that means. Yeah? So they believe in a lot of spirituality. What's that? Be careful. The true believer, Peter says, pursues goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. He says that in chapter 1 of 2 Peter, verse 5. The false believer is marked by arrogance and slander. Chapter 2, verse 7. Arrogance and slander. They are experts in greed, and their eyes are full of adultery. They despise authority. Right there in the world. Chapter 2, verses 10, 14. 10 and 14. There is a marked difference. The true believer is effective and productive in his or her knowledge of Jesus Christ. First, he says that in chapter 1, 2 Peter 1:8. 2 Peter 2:17, he says the false believer is empty, like a spring without water. The true believer will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So he says in 2 Peter 1:11, the false believer will experience destruction. Verses 1 and 2 of 2 Peter chapter 2. There is a clear mark, a clear distance between a true believer and a false believer. Didn't Jesus say it? Jesus tells us that there will be many who will be involved in ministry in his name. Many will say, Lord, Lord. And what is response will be? Matthew chapter 6. What is response will be? Depart from me, I never knew you. Who are these people Jesus will ask? Surely Peter was describing those people in that passage as false believers. We are not to be naive. There are false teachers and false believers among us. Among the many wonderful people who come through the doors of the sanctuary. Some will be more harm than good. And is the truth. That's the truth. They may seem the nicest of people, but they don't believe in the authority of the Bible or the salvation of Jesus Christ. We ought, however, to welcome such people because they need Christ as much as we do. But we must be careful about the influence that they have on the church. You know, you go through in Acts of the Apostles, it mentions the fact that they wanted some people to tend tables, serve the tables. And they were directed by Peter to find the people who were filled with the Holy Spirit to tend tables. You know the emphasis is? You know what the emphasis is? Whatever we do in the house of the Lord is ministry. Whatever we do in the house of the Lord is as unto the Lord. And the truth is, you can't work for the Lord if you are not filled with His Holy Spirit. With the best intention in the world. With the best intention in the world. One of the reasons people give for not following Christ is they've seen people in the church who are hypocrites. Not too much a hypocrite in the church. I always reply to that, if I hypocrite in the market, you may as well. If I hypocrite in the grocery, you go there too. The truth is there is no perfect church. There is no perfect church on earth. We serve a perfect God. But the existence of hypocrites, or the existence of counterfeit in the church, is that a good reason to reject the genuine God? Is that really a reason for rejecting the genuine God? Yeah, people might be hypocrite, but God, you know hypocrite. God is God. There are lots of other scriptures that talks about false believers, 2 Corinthians 11, 13 to 15, Titus 1, 16, I made mention earlier of Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23, Matthew 7, 15, Timothy 3, 5. Paul tells us about false teachers. This is this should give us a clear idea who is a believer. So for the sake of this study that we are doing, in terms of who, I would want to use the term from here on, true believer. True believer. Because that is who God calls us to be. Not people who just believe that God exists. James tells us, the demons believe that too. So just believe. We want people who will follow Jesus. We want true believers. We want people who are saved. Who understands their salvation. Who seeks to learn more about God. As the Baptist has this good looking to say, people who are on the battlefield for the Lord. The next question I said that we must answer is, who owns believers? Who owns believers? Before I go to that, any thoughts, any views, any questions you want to ask for this time? As it relates to who are believers, true believers, false believers. Alright, so we want to move on to who owns true believers. The Bible makes some significant statements regarding who owns true believers. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 says this. Don't you know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that place. Because God's temple is holy and you are that temple. And you are that temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Verses 19 and 20 says, you should know that your body is a temple for the Holy Spirit who is in you and was given to you by God. So you do not belong to yourselves because you were bought by God for a price. So honor God with your bodies. You were bought by God. King James uses and has that, you were bought with a price. The significance of these statements become more obvious when we know that the Spirit of God is God. And His assignment is to seal God's people. Some years ago, when my mom was alive, she and I had this discussion about seals. And I remember saying to her that the only seal that the Bible talks about as it relates to believers is the fact that believers are sealed by the Spirit of God. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 to 14 records this. So it is with you, Paul says to Ephesians. When you heard the true teaching, the good news about your salvation, you believe in Christ. And in Christ, God put His special mark of ownership on you by giving you the Holy Spirit. Some versions have, having been sealed with the Holy Spirit that He had promised. That Holy Spirit is the guarantee that we will receive what God promised for His people until God gives full freedom to those who are His to bring praise to God's glory. That Holy Spirit is the guarantee. So, that Holy Spirit is God's seal on our lives. By being filled with the Holy Spirit means we are guaranteed to inherit eternal life. Without the Holy Spirit, there is no life. He is the seed. He is the seed. when we become Christians, well, as a matter of fact, that is what makes us Christians. We are made, we are Christians when we are filled with God's Holy Spirit. That is how we are identified as children. That's how we are identified as children. It's not as though you just wake up and say, you're a child of God. That would be very good. But that's not what it is. It is when we are filled with God's Spirit. That is how God knows who are His and who are those who are filled by, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Paul said to me, and that word sons can be correctly translated, the children of God. It is the Spirit of God who makes us children of God. If we do not have God's Spirit, then we are not the children of God. But why we are given God's Spirit, like I said, just one of the journeys of God giving us His Spirit, because He is our seal. He is our seal. He identifies us as the children of God. He identifies us as the children of God. But not only does He identify us as the children of God, one of the other jobs of the Holy Spirit is that He protects true believers against anything from the enemy, against the enemy. Just today I was sharing this with someone. Remember it. The enemy is not afraid, the devil is not afraid of you. He is. Why? Because we cannot fight him in ourselves. We don't have, by ourselves, we do not have the strength to fight him. We will always be defeated. But you see, that is the difference with ordinary man and the Christian. I almost never talk so much. The ordinary man and the Christian. The Christian is man plus God. That makes the difference. So that when it comes to ordinary man, man by himself, we don't match for the enemy, But the true believer, the child of God, is a different scenario. The child of God is man plus God. The only person, the enemy, the only person, the devil, is afraid of is God. The only person the devil can't defeat is God. Can't defeat God. So that when the child of God comes in the presence of the enemy, God, who lives in us, is prominent. So the devil knows he cannot win. He can't win that war. That's a battle he can't win. Why? Because he can't defeat God. He can't defeat God. In order to defeat us, he has to defeat God. And he can't do that. Can't do that. So the Holy Spirit, it is He who protects us against the enemy. It is He. In the Bible, a lot in the New Testament, believers was a word that is used predominantly in the first part of the New Testament. Like, I want to Acts of the Apostles. If you're reading from the Gospels through the Acts, a lot of times you'll bounce up the word believers. However, if you, in the epistles, the letters that were written, when you get into Romans and 1st and 2nd Corinthians and all the letters, you will hardly find the word believers. You find the word, you won't find the word disciples. Now a disciple is a follower. It is primarily the word disciple used is primarily refers to a dedicated follower of Jesus Christ. So the word disciple is used in the same way we use the word believer. It's used in the same term. The question is, God's Spirit is God. Because we established that this, God's Spirit is God. If God's Spirit is God, and He lives within us, and sees us, then how likely is it that another spiritual power can possess us? How likely is that? God owns the universe. True believers are owned by Almighty God. Remember, He bought us with a price. And the demon who desires to possess a true believer must overcome God first. See, Satan isn't strong enough to defeat God. God is too mighty to be overcome by Him. So as true believers, we can rest assured that Satan cannot possess us. But what is the implication of that truth for us? It is not known for us to worship our churches and our holidays. That is not the implication of the truth. The implication of the truth is this. We can face spiritual battles knowing that Satan cannot get control of us. That is as long as we are true believers. We sing a song. I'm in Christ forever. Once we stay in Christ, Colossians chapter 1 verse 13 tells us, God has freed us from the power of darkness and He brought us into the kingdom of His dear Son. Freed us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of His dear Son. Satan can't take us back. He can't take us back from God. He will not ultimately win in the believer's life because he cannot defeat God. Now mind you, the fact that he cannot win doesn't stop him from trying. Remember, it doesn't stop him from trying. Yeah, you know, he can't win, but if he attempted, if he went after Christ, who is he after? If he went after Christ, I don't believe, based on scripture, that Christians can be demon possessed. However, there are those who claim to be Christians that can be demon possessed. Paul warned Titus about imposters of the faith. In Titus chapter 1, verse 15 to 16, Paul said this to Titus, "To the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are corrupted, do not believe, nothing is pure. In fact, both their minds and consciences are corrupted. They claim to know God, but by their actions they deny Him. They are detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good." Anytime scripture like these comes up, there might be an inclination for us to think, well, we need to be perfect. The scriptures do not say that. We will not be perfect at this time. We will be perfect. We will make mistakes. We will trip up sometimes. We will do it. But you know what? The only question is for the child of God. Recognizing where we are wrong and getting back on that sweet road. Getting back on track with Jesus. That's where the emphasis is for the child of God. We fall down, as some writers say, but we get up. We get up and we move ahead. We seek God's forgiveness for the past. Oh, Paul puts it, forgetting what is behind, I press towards the prize for the mark of the high calling of God in Jesus Christ. Because if I keep looking back at my mistakes and my trip-ups, I'll never be able to focus on the prize of the mark of the high calling of God. And that is what it is. Once our eyes are fixed on the high calling of God, then it means when we make mistakes that get us off track, As soon as we realize we're off track, we get back on track. We get back on track. That's what Paul said to Titus. They came to know God, but their actions, but by their actions, they denied Him. One last question. Can demons have any influence on true believers? Can demons? Now, I don't believe demons could possess true believers. But can they have influence on true believers? I believe they can. We studied the armor of God. Put on the whole armor in Ephesians chapter 6. Yeah? And in verse 11 of chapter 6, he says, put on the whole armor of God so that you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the enemy. That's all. So if the enemy had no ammunition, if the enemy had no arms, we wouldn't be there. If the enemy didn't have influence over us, we wouldn't need armor. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Peter says, the devil is as a roaring lion seeking whom he could devour. If the lion had nothing, he can't devour. So the darts of the enemy shoot at us are fiery. He was brazen enough to attack Jesus. That's how brazen he was. He can't possess us, but that doesn't mean he's not throwing darts. That doesn't mean he doesn't want to trip you. The benefit we have as believers is this. He cannot go further than he's allowed by God. Go back to the book of Job. The devil had to ask God's permission to attack Job. And even when God gave him permission, God gave him boundaries that he couldn't cross. God gave him boundaries that he had to stay with him. The enemy's influence could be incredibly strong. Sometimes he's so persistent and powerful that he attacks our very souls seem to be tormented under his attacks. He attacks strong. Four primary ways the enemy tries to oppress the true believers is this. One, he accuses us and gives us false messages about ourselves. He tells us we're no good and God doesn't love you. He keeps bombarding us with these messages until finally we lose him. Let me tell you something. No matter what the devil or anybody tell you, or any demon from hell tell you, God loves you. No matter what they tell you how bad you are, yeah, God know that, but He loves you still. Sometimes the enemy leads you to doubt, question your salvation. I wonder why truly step by truly step by. And then you see, then you hear some doctor or somebody say, if you're saved, you have to be doing this. And you find you're not doing that. So yeah, you question it. What? The enemy, he discourages us, and the persistent discouragement leads to a decrease in our hope of victory. I can't win by it. I go through life righteous, only fighting, struggling. It's when, as soon as I seem to raise up my head, something else coming back to push me down. He reintroduces sin strongholds in our lives. By continual temptation, and he causes us to lose our will to fight. This had a stronghold on you. God took you out of the darkness, brought you into the light. But the enemy, he's enough. He always pushing you and prompting you and sticking you. And you have a problem with drinking. So you decide to see me, I wonder. He's up. I cannot even, I finish this drinking thing. Are you still here? Over and over again. As a matter of fact, when you're drinking, the fellas in the office say, you must ask me if you're going to have a Friday night. Because I'm going to have a Friday night. Nobody will ask you. That's what you decide. You know, it's every Friday when the lines get more frequent than Friday. Like it's every day. They have to go online. And the only problem and problem, you could just hang out. You don't have to drink nothing. You could drink a soft drink. You could drink a water. You could drink a drink. That is just to get you back there. He to reintroduce that stronghold. That's what it is. That's what he does. That's what he puts us. What actions should true believers take? If you sense that you're under the persistent, long-term effect of spiritual oppression, just a couple of things that you could do. One, enlist a team of prayer partners who will pray for you to experience freedom. Let me tell you something. There is power in prayer. There is power in prayer. How about this? But then Satan trembles when he sees the weakest saint upon the knees. I said, I'm just putting some hands together. Because, listen to it. On your knees means you recognize the sovereignty of God. So you're in a position where you are calling down, calling on the strength of God to deliver. That is the one of the enemy is afraid of. He's afraid of God. If you want to take care of you'll take care of. But as you start to call on God for help, so that's one thing to enlist a team of prayer partners. Church, let me just say this in quickly in passing because we almost listen. We have to respect people's prayers. I know that and I understand that. And I agree with that. You have to respect people's privacy. There are some people who are very private and they prefer not to tell people their business. That is what. But church, if you come in to the house of God, come on, and there are people that there must be at least one person, there must be at least one Christian person who you fellowship with, who you have a relationship with, that if something ain't right with you, something, or you feel under the persistent attack of the enemy, or you know you're going through a difficult time fighting off the enemy, there must be at least one person you could come to in confidence and ask them to pray with you. Don't let the enemy outsmart you, sir. Don't let the enemy defeat you, sir. Do not let your privacy obstruct the power that you have available, the resource that you have available. The other thing you can do is the Bible tells us about a pattern that is established for overcoming the enemy. Submit to God. Resist the enemy. He will flee from. Submit to God. The more the harder you try, the more you submit to God. Resist the enemy. Resist him. Don't play no super Christian. Resist the enemy. You know you have weaknesses, stay away. Resist them. Confess to God any sin in your life. Even if you're going to be as private as Paul, you can't be too private for God. Tell God about your sin in your life. Have a own relationship with God. There's one thing I can assure you this morning. He will tell nobody. The secret is good with God. The final word. And that goes right back to what I was saying last time. Confess your struggles. Invite somebody to pray with you. Invite some Christian brother, some Christian sister to pray with you, to pray for you. We are encouraging you both to pray for one another. Pray for one another. Don't let another woman lead to death. Let's pray for one another. Demon possession. Those are the thoughts of demon possession. I said it last week that we were going to talk about demon possession, but I didn't give any scriptures. So please, now that you're feeling, check the scriptures. If there are any questions you want, you can send the questions to me for myself. Please send them before. You can't wait till next Wednesday, right? If you're sending questions, please, we will look at them. We will have an answer for you my next Wednesday, so. Alright? Demon possession is the topic. Or if there's anything concerning demon possession that you thought of that wasn't mentioned here, please send a note to Leon and we will look at it. Alright, thank you so much for being with us. Thank you for spending this time with us. It is my prayer that something said tonight will have stirred you up to continue this battle. Continue this fight that we are in. Continue this warfare. Because we are in fact in warfare. Let us go to God. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the revelation of the word. Father God, much is said about this battle that we are in, about the enemy that we are fighting. Much is said. We recognize tonight, God, we recognize all along that we cannot fight this enemy by ourselves. We need you. Now more than ever, we need you every minute, every hour of every day. Strengthen us, God. Strengthen us as we go from day to day. Strengthen us, God, to continue holding on to you. Strengthen us so that we can never reach that place where we think we had enough of you, and we think that we can make it on our own. Strengthen us to always look to you, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Always depend upon you. Always call upon you. Always. As we face the rest of the week ahead of us, I ask that you will guide and direct those on the workplace as they go out to work. Continue to protect, guide, and direct them. Father God, just continue to keep us as your people. We are unable to do it ourselves. We are dependent on you. As we continue, oh God, you continue to be our God. As we seek to continue to be your people, continue to minister to us. Continue to guide us. Continue to strengthen us to live in accordance with your will. You continue to be our God. Now may the blessings of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest with you and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Good evening.